Yesterday, one of the largest recorded earthquakes in human history struck, leading to tsunamis striking almost every nation in the Pacific Ocean, even causing measurable tsunami waves to strike as far away as Antarctica. Yet, in many of these locations, if you were to look at the ocean, you'd likely still see the water behaving in an unusual manner. As, while the tsunami has technically passed, all of the reflected energy from the tsunami impacting various coastlines and other objects has caused lesser water level variations to occur, as you can see in this NOAA time gauge chart, which I have specifically chosen because this spot saw the highest tsunami waves strike one of the 8 main Hawaiian islands. These variations are still ongoing more than 24 hours later and could continue easily for another 24 hours, although these abnormalities would decrease over time until it ceases altogether. However, there were no reports of tsunami damage outside of Russia, although a viewer of mine who lives north-northwest of Seattle saw a 1.5-foot-high tsunami strike which brought in and left behind this large log. Regardless, despite hundreds of millions of dollars in damage having been caused, essentially all within Russia, something seemed a bit off about the July 30th magnitude 8.8 earthquake. Simply put, when comparing to other megathrust earthquakes of vaguely similar magnitudes, the tsunamis which ended up being generated were only about one-third the height of what initially seemed most likely. For example, while the town of Severokurilsk was hit by a 6-meter-high tsunami, it theoretically should have been hit by a 12 to 18-meter-high tsunami, given the extremely large magnitude and duration of the quake in question. After all, a magnitude 9.0 earthquake striking essentially the same location in 1952 led to Severokurilsk being struck by an 18-meter or 59-foot-high tsunami, killing 2,300 of the town's residents. So, while yes, the very lowest-lying portions of this modern town were washed away by a still-damaging tsunami, it could have easily been much worse. So, why wasn't it? Before I answer this question, I want to remind my viewers that Severokurilsk as a whole was moved inland and to notably higher ground after the 1952 earthquake, hence why a mere 18-meter-high tsunami figure might seem strange if the center of that town today is located at 28 meters above sea level. While a few suggestions have been put forward, in my opinion, the true explanation is likely a combination of several of these. For example, one suggestion was that perhaps there was actually a tsunami wave of the expected height, just the regions which should have been hit by the largest tsunamis were completely uninhabited, so the true tsunami extent is incomplete, relying on very spotty data. Some support can potentially be given to this idea because it appears that the neighboring Shumshu Island was hit by around a 12-meter or 39-foot-high tsunami. However, two other factors can also help us explain this. First, the maximum slip of the seafloor surface area which moved during the earthquake was about half as large as comparable magnitude earthquakes with larger tsunamis, and since the maximum slip was lower, so was the resulting tsunami. Also, while other recent megathrust earthquakes being referenced struck at around 30 kilometers depth, the Kamchatka quake struck a little deeper at 35 kilometers depth. And, initially, the earthquake was incorrectly modeled as having an epicenter at 20 kilometers depth. The shallower a megathrust earthquake is, generally speaking, the larger the resulting tsunami will end up being. And, current models suggest that the megathrust earthquake did generate both widespread landslides and liquefaction, especially along steep coastal cliff faces for landslides, but this mostly occurred in unpopulated areas. In other words, while both of these hazards did likely affect local citizens, in each case the number of people living in potentially impacted regions was 2,000 and 3,000 respectively. So far, 220 aftershocks have struck of magnitude 4 or larger, already including 5 separate magnitude 6 range earthquakes. Now, the possibility still does remain that one or more aftershocks eventually could strike that are large enough to cause a more localized tsunami, but earthquakes can't be specifically predicted, only given a stated frequency of events based off of rates of aftershocks after historical earthquakes of similar magnitude. Once more thorough data becomes available, I plan to make a detailed tsunami height map to illustrate the extent of the waves which struck. As a final note, I would like to thank my new patron, Peggy Smith, for supporting my work.